please stand as you are able. And we will start with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the days that you have given us, and we praise your holy name. We love you, Lord, and we lift up this time, and we lift up this congregation. And we lift up this day and this community, and we just ask that the Holy Spirit be here amongst us, that you would help us to honor you and to worship you, that you would bring us closer to you. And we ask all these things in his name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Slave to sin, I wanna know about being born again. I need you. distant, just some words on a page. That you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. But I've seen you part the waters when no one else could feel me from the deep. That's who you are to me.
Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone. I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. I've seen you in the sunset, in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me.
Everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love? Yeah.
Father of life, seated on your throne of grace, it's only by your mercy we are saved. Lord, if you say, if we call upon your name, we and our families will be saved. So we cry out your name, El Shaddai, God of grace, Lord Most High, Jesus Christ.
Today is a new day. It will bring brand new blessings and brand new battles. but within every uncertainty, there is hidden possibility. So I don't dread any challenge that lies ahead, because I remember all the victories behind. And my confidence is not in my circumstance. The Spirit of God is my supply. I'm steady under pressure, and I'm ready for whatever, because whatever comes my way today, the outcome is I overcome. Christ is in me. I am enough. I can handle it. I can't afford to stay afraid or let my faith hesitate. My purpose is at stake. And he who called me is faithful. His strength in me is greater than any pain I feel or enemy I face. The promise of God is mine for the taking. Every plan he has made is guaranteed to come to pass. It will happen. If I don't back down, if I won't let go, it will happen. If I don't stop short, if I won't sell out, it will happen by faith. But faith doesn't take the fear away. It teaches me to fight it. So bring the battle. I'm ready now. I got something for Goliath. I can handle it. My power flows from presence. So I won't stay stuck in what was or worry about what will be. My regrets have been redeemed, and my tests have become my lessons. My focus is fixed, and my heart is expectant. I'm set. I'm not nervous about what's next, because my eyes are on the throne. I trust the one who's in complete control, the one who already knows how he's gonna work it according to his purpose. Even the worst situations are sure to turn in my favor. If I keep moving forward, keep moving toward him, God is with me in this moment. And whatever happens, I can handle it. I know my help comes from above. So if fear insists on knocking, I'll meet it at the door. Life might give me bad news, but I've still got a good report. I can handle it. If I fall, if I fail, I'll handle it. Grace will give me what it takes to carry on. I can handle it. I have humbled myself under the mighty hand of God. Christ is in me. I am enough. And when the time is right, he'll lift me up. Till then, the lion may roar, but I see his leash. So I keep moving forward, because I've been down before, but my hope knows how to bounce back from rock bottom. What I need, God's got it.
Good morning. We're still talking about owning it, taking some responsibility in our life. Amen. And God, he is in everything and works through all of us. I believe that wholeheartedly. We have a saying here at our church, a need seen is an assignment given. If you're walking down the hallway and you see a piece of paper on the floor, you don't look for somebody else and say, hey, we need to pick that up. We pick that up. And we throw it away. A need seen is an assignment given. In other words, in ministry, when we see somebody in need, we help them. That is what it's all about. God has called us to this ministry. He didn't call me. He called all of us together to a ministry to serve him and to serve others. And I'm reminded of that regularly. You know, how many of y'all would call yourself a Christian? That's a Christ follower, right? And with great position comes great responsibility. A need seen is an assignment given. We're going to look at some things this morning that I believe will be helpful to us as we continue to look at Nehemiah. We're going to be in chapter 2. Y'all remember Nehemiah? He was a cupbearer of a king that was not a Hebrew king. The Jews have been conquered. They've been taken over. They've been scattered. Now they're coming back to Jerusalem, Judea. They're finding out he got word that his city gates have been burned, that the walls have been crumbled. But he finds himself in this unique position. He finds himself in a position that could be influential. And the king actually noticed, remember last week, his downcast face. Why are you so sad? Well, why wouldn't I be sad, O king? The city that I grew up in, the city that my ancestors are buried in, lies in ruins. And he said, well, what would you like? What are you asking me? And he said, well, if it be okay with the king, would you send me to rebuild my city? And the king says, well, how long would that take? So he gave him a date, and the king had sent him. Now we see him, he gets to the city, he begins to take a look at things, he begins to make a plan, he begins to prioritize. That's what we're going to look at here this morning, prioritizing and executing what God has placed in your heart, in the heart of his people. He says this in verse 11, Nehemiah chapter 2, 11, I went to Jerusalem. After staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. I hadn't told everyone that God had placed in my heart to come and to help rebuild this city. There were no mounts with me except the one that I was riding on. And by night, I went through the valley gate toward the jackal wall and the dung gate. I examined the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up the valley by night, examined the wall, and finally I returned. I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The big idea here is success requires a developed plan and committed action. I love this when we see someone taking their time to evaluate what's going on all around them. Kind of study in the room. I love it whenever people participate. Whenever I'm preaching, I can tell on your face if you're smiling, if you're just ticked off or whatever. I mean, you know, I can read it. But sometimes I'm in a situation like yesterday. I had the privilege to speak at Angie's grandpa's funeral. He's 90 years old. But I got to talk, and her family, they're a little more, I guess I would call them straight-laced. They're just serious people. And I don't come from serious people. So for me, it was a little different. I got done. I sat down by Angie, and she said, good job, honey, real quietly to me. And I go, I don't know. I hope they were okay. But then later, you know, of course, they all reassured me. They loved me too, even though Angie brought me into this family. And they blame her, not me, which is great. But so thrilled that they have accepted me that I get to be a part of that. But I look out here and I can kind of study those things. I think that it's important that we assess the situation in our own life. You know, what is broken and needs rebuilt in our life? In your own personal life, what would you say is broken and need rebuilt? Maybe it's your relationship with your spouse this morning. Maybe it's the relationship you have with Jesus today. Maybe it's the relationship you have with extended family from past hurts and messed up situations. If you got your listening guide, I'd like for you to open those up with me this morning. The very first thing on there is two blanks. Honestly assess the circumstances. Honestly assess the circumstances. Romans chapter 3, 23, we're going to be getting there here in just a second. But there's some keys to assess. You know, these are the big things when we honestly assess these circumstances. We got to be honest with ourselves. I always wanted to be a running back. Football team starting up next week. My whole life I wanted to be a running back. I wanted to run the ball. I wanted a touchdown. That's all I wanted. But I run in slow motion. When I'm giving it everything I got, it is in slow motion for everybody else. And I try really hard. I mean, I remember I would come to the coach every year and I would say, Coach, I would get done. You know, we'd be going through the whole summer. I would work out. I haul hay. I did all kinds of stuff. And I would say to him, I'd say, Coach, I'm fast this year. He'd say, you're going to be a fast lineman. I remember my freshman year. I'll never forget this. This kind of ruined it for me the rest of the time. But I was also a punter. It never occurred to me that a punter could run the ball. Until one time we had to punt, and the coach says, whatever you do, Thomas, don't run. Kick the ball. And I thought, that's my chance. I'm going to show him. And I made it 3 steps. And it hurt pretty bad. I had to be honest with myself. It was just, you know, I had a quick 3 steps. I could lay a hurt on somebody. In 3 steps, I could about knock them out. But after 3 steps, I need water and rest. We got to be real about our circumstances, don't we? There's certain things that we could be good at and certain things that we're just not good at. There's certain situations where we know we're going to come undone or where we know we can handle it and keep it together. But can we begin to be honest with ourselves and with what we're facing? Maybe it's an illness in your life. Maybe it's a situation like that. Confront the reality and make a plan to overcome. You know, in reality, the Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's a reality. We're all sinners. The Bible says that our righteousness is but filthy rags before the Lord. In other words, no matter how good you think you are, your good is not good enough to get you into heaven by yourself. It's only by the grace of God that you and I can be saved. That's our situation. That's really who we are. We are made good enough through Jesus. The Bible says it this way in 1 John 1:9, that if we confess our sins, that He, that's Jesus, is faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us or purify us from all unrighteousness. Here's the second thing I want you to see this morning. We need to build a team to accomplish more. We need to build a team to accomplish more. You know, I need others to help me. I still grow in the English language. We have some teachers in our church. I am grateful that they show grace to me. Because I still use words like ain't and can't. And even put the slang in there, you know. Me and my mom, we have our own language. We talk to one another occasionally, and we'll say, you know, can you grab the thing over by the deal? No one else knows what we're talking about, but we know exactly what we're talking about. And I go over by the deal and get the thing and bring it back to her and say, here's the thing that was by the deal. Because we can't remember what it was called. It might have been a cup or whatever. But she understands me. I need to build a team to accomplish more. I need others. Listen to me, who are better than I am at lots of things. It's okay that I'm not good at everything. You know, I'd like to be a singer. Oh, I would. Oh, I wish I could sing. But I can't. And people are so nice to me. They say, Rusty, when you sing, it sounds so pretty. I know you're lying. It's cool. But you shouldn't lie at church. All right? At least wait till we get in the parking lot or something. But I appreciate how nice you are to me. I'm so thankful for our team. I'm thankful for Sarah. I'm thankful for all these people that come up here and they can play and sing and do those things. I'm thankful for the people that work in our kids ministry. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I asked one lady one time, I won't bring her name up because she's here every week. I asked her to help out in the kids ministry. She said, I'd hurt them. I'm like, okay, we don't need you back there. We're good. But those people really are better at that than me. There's some of you here. Listen, I love building stuff. I do. I like using nail guns. I like, there's something about making stuff square, though. They say it really helps. Door frames. My buddy Rick over here on the front fixed a lot of those for me. There's so many things about building that I love, but I'm dangerous. And we have to surround ourselves with people that know more about that. In your life, what are you really good at, right? And who can you bring on alongside you to accomplish the things that God has called you to accomplish? You need people in your life. You need people to help you in life. Maybe it's counseling. Maybe it's getting somebody's opinion. Maybe it's understanding that they've been there and they've done that and they got the T-shirt. Maybe you're struggling being a good husband, but you look over and you see a guy that seems to have it all together. Maybe he has together in that area of his life, and it's cool to draw some understanding and some encouragement from him. And maybe then he can look at you and say, man, I don't know nothing about this weed whacker. Can you help me? I tell people we have small groups in our church. And actually, we're getting ready to kick off and launch a new semester of small groups. You'll see in the next few weeks out in the lobby, there'll begin to be tags that are hanging on that rolly cart that sits at the end of the black table right before you go out. And those will have a couple's picture on them, and it'll have their address, and it'll have a place for you to call them on the back of their card to say, I would like to join that small group. These small groups, this is designed so that we grow and we begin to learn who each other are. They're designed that we would surround ourselves with people that are better than us in certain things, that we build community, that we begin to understand how God has connected us. It's designed so that we would draw encouragement from one another. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11, therefore encourage one another. Paul's telling us to encourage one another and build each other up. You ever been somewhere where you didn't feel built up? I've been there. It was Fort Leonard Wood, 1995, February, cold. Well, actually January, but end of January, February. It snowed really hard that year. We got to all, you know, you can move a lot of snow on the road with like 300 privates and some shovels. You don't even need a truck with a plow on it. I've learned that. I watched, you know, these guys tear you down and then one day they'll build you back up, but the tearing down part wasn't fun at all. We kind of expect that at basic training, don't we? Somebody say, yeah. We don't expect that at church, do we? And I've talked to people, they say, man, Rusty, I went to church and I felt tore down and I felt beat up, but I get that everywhere else. I get that at work. I get that at basic training. I get that at home sometimes. But what God tells us that we have this job, we need one another, therefore encourage one another, build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. So he's not coming down on them. He's saying, I see you doing it. Do it some more. Nehemiah didn't build the wall on his own. You know, it took him 52 days under intense opposition to build this wall. And he did it with much help. Friend, if I could give you any advice this morning, I would say love your team. Love your family. That's my team. I never forget Angie and I and the kids. We moved to Texas so I could go to seminary there. We knew some people that lived in Texas. We called them 2 weeks before. They said, we'll be there to help you unload the truck. So there were people here that helped us load our truck. And we get down there, and I call the guy, and he says, oh, I forgot. We're in San Antonio, like 5 hours away. We're not going to be back for like a week and a half. I have to turn in the truck like next tomorrow, right? And I remember I had this group meeting. It was me and Angie, and I think Megan was like first or second grade, and Zachary was younger than that by 3 years, and little Kyle. I said, I need all of you. Kyle, even you will carry a pillow if you can find one. But everybody's going to grab stuff on this truck, and we're carrying it in. Your family's your team, amen? Love your team, love your family, love your friends. Nehemiah told this story to them. He painted the vision. He inspires the people. Look in verse 17 through 18, Nehemiah 2, 17 and 18. Then he said this, then I said to them, you see the trouble we're in? Jerusalem lies in ruins. Its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and we will no longer be in disgrace. I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me when the king had said, and what the king had said to me. How long will it take? How long will you be gone? Go and do it. And the king gave him the resources. This, if you read all of Nehemiah, the king, even from his own, the woods that he kind of ruled over, he gave them trees and lumber, and he gave them all the things they needed to furnish the building of this city back. So they replied, "Let us start building." So they began this good work. Man, everybody was fired up. You know, preachers, I talk to them. A lot of preachers act beat down, and they see our situation. God is growing this church, and I'm excited about that. They tell me, they say, "Rusty, why do 10% of the people do 90% of the work?" And I say, it doesn't really matter how big you get. That's what it feels like, but that's not really what's going on. You see, our perception's not really reality. There's many people that may not be physically putting their hand to the plow, but they're putting their knees to the floor, and they're praying every single day. There are people that are physically able to do physical work, and then there's people that are able to do the spiritual, the mental, the other tough stuff that has to take place. The problem is we only see what we're involved with. And I want to tell these other guys, don't be discouraged. Here's the third thing this morning. Leverage strengths and resources for success. Leverage your strengths. The people you know that are better at that than you, the resources you might be able to tap into that can bring things together for success. Look at Nehemiah 3, 28 through 29. Above the horse gate, the priests made repairs, each in front of his own house. Next to them, Zadok, son of Immer, made repairs opposite his house. Next to him, Shemaiah, son of Shechaniah, these are great words, aren't they? The guard at the east gate made repairs. These are people that are just looking out their front door. They're seeing a need. That's their assignment given. You know, I could work the rest of my life on my faults. I could work the rest of my life trying to be fast. And I might get a little faster. I might have a little more agility. I might be a little more flexible. Or I could spend my time being the best version of me, concentrating on my strengths, surrounding myself with people who are better than me in my weaknesses, engaging with resources that come our way. Many of y'all know Jeff Brandt. He'll be in here second service. He's usually out front. He's our executive pastor here. I'm so thankful for Jeff. I can't thank you all enough for bringing him on full time to be a part here. Jeff and I are very different. We describe ourselves as I'm the gas pedal, he's the brake. We need that. You know, a car without a brake, that's not a good thing. You know what I'm saying? It gets pretty dangerous. And for a while, we've just been running like that. I'm so thankful for that. When I preach one way. When he preaches another way. Praise God that we're not exactly alike. When he looks at finances, he sees one thing. When I look at finances, I see another. It's good. You see, God is strategically placing people all around us. When I look at Mike Hedrick and how he loves teenagers, I'm so thankful for him. I could go on, the list is good and big, and the people that love to work in the kitchen, I love to eat, so it just works. Here's the final thing this morning. Prayer and planning prepares us for action. Never underestimate the importance of prayer. I tell people we don't pray before we work. Prayer is the work, and then God works. It is the engine to the whole thing. I mean, he said in the Old Testament, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then will I hear from heaven, I'll heal their land. There's this engine, it's called prayer. He says, cast your cares on me, for I care for you. The Lord tells us to not be afraid to approach the throne of grace in our time of need, that we may find comfort in Him. He's telling us to give our petitions, let them be known to the Lord. You see, prayer connects us to God, the God who gave us a compelling vision, just like He gave a compelling vision to Nehemiah about what he was to do. It wasn't word for word and task by task. It's amazing how God just opens the door and He shows us what to do in our heart. Prayer helps clarify the vision and the priority. See, planning helps us to be aware of and think about contingencies. Y'all heard the old saying, if we don't plan, we plan to fail. I'm big in planning. You know, the Bible says, in a man's heart are many plans, but God's purpose prevails. Praise the Lord. I mean, my plans are not always the best, but it's awesome how God, I want to leave room for Him to change them if He wants to. I mean, I have a vision of what God wants for LifePoint, but I want to say, God, not my will, Your will be done. God, You throw the brakes on anytime You want, but until then, we're going to keep the gas pedal down. You know, few things go according to plan, at least our plans. Nehemiah 4:21 through 23, so we continued the work with half the men holding spears. From the first light of dawn till the stars came out, and at that time, I also said to the people, have every man and his helper stay inside Jerusalem at night so they can serve as a guard by night and workers by day. See, there was great opposition. The king had figured out kind of what was going on. Now there were threats coming at them and they had to stay alert. They had to work at night. They had to be guards by night and workers by day. Neither I nor my brothers nor my men nor the guards with me took off their clothes. Each had his weapon even when he went for water. Prayer helps us to be tenacious. Helps you to see it through, to finish the task. Helps us to hold on to the vision that God has given us. Helps us to see it realized. I pray every day for 30,000 people in the Pettis County area that don't go to church. It don't mean they don't believe in God. It don't mean that they don't have a relationship with God. Many of them tell me, Rusty, look, I don't have to go to church to have a relationship with God. I say, you're right. But I don't know about you. I want to be surrounded by more God's people. And the Bible says don't quit meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. So I believe God wants us together. He wants us to be encouraged by one another. I want to realize that vision that God has for us to reach the lost and the unchurched in Pettis County. Listen, if it's God's will, are you going to pray it through? Are you going to see it through? What's broken in your life today? Are you going to pray it through? Are you going to see it through? Are you going to accept responsibility? Are you going to see a need and fill the need? This morning we have some next steps I want you to consider. I want you to consider developing your growth plan and act on it. So you got three things there listed. Area of growth. What's God's vision for your life? What's God's vision for your life? It says person to tell. Who are you going to invite on this journey with you that can help you? Maybe it's a counselor. Maybe it's a friend. What action are you going to take? What are you going to do different? Let us pray. God, I love You and I thank You and I praise You for this day. God, for this opportunity to be used by You. God, I pray You'd help us to own it today. Take responsibility for what You put in our life and in our world and in our circle. God, I pray that we wouldn't be afraid to repair damaged walls, to fix things that are broken, to forgive people that we don't want to forgive sometimes, to love people that sometimes we don't want to love. God, I pray that you would just be with each and every person in this place. That God, we would really look at who we are, that we'd really assess who we are, that we'd be honest, that we'd remember that we are sinners saved by grace, and God, that you want to do the same for everyone. God, I pray that you'd lead us to be the church that you've called us to be in this community and our surrounding community. That God, many people would come to know who you are, that their lives would be changed. God, use this church to glorify you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Would you come today? Would you stand with us? This is an invitation. It's a chance for you to respond to the Lord. If you're online with us today, we want to invite you to call into one of those numbers at the bottom of the screen. We'd like to pray with you today. You come as God leads right now. There is no end to what its power can do. Come on, friend.
So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Oh, forgiveness. Forgiveness. Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible.
We're going to take an offering at this time. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this day. Bless this offering to your guidance and your use in this community and this church. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you didn't pick up a listening guide, try to pick up one on your way out. There's lots of announcements on there. Our next Starting Point class is September the 12th. This next Tuesday morning is our men's group at 6 a.m. So that's the last one of this series. I think Rusty's going to do another one in the fall. It's been a great time. We've had 12 to 15 guys show up every Tuesday morning at 6. So it's a great, great time. Gals of Promise, August the 20th. Mary Pace back here is running that at 9 a.m. in the cafe. That's on Friday, the August the 20th, I think it is, isn't it? Fridays? All right. Rusty mentioned small groups. There are several small groups in the church. There's some cards out on the card out there to pick up if you'd like to be part of that. It's a great way to get connected and fellowship. Youth group starts back up September the 12th at 6:30 here at the church. Don't forget October the 10th down at our place south of Sedalia. We're going to have a fall farm fest, a bonfire, weenie roast, games and stuff like that. Have a great time for food, fun, and fellowship from 4 to 9. That's a Sunday afternoon on October the 10th. Jake let me know this morning. She does have all the prayer partners. There's about 12 of us that are going to Puerto Rico in 2 weeks to do some mission work down there. And we're so thankful for what she's done and getting together those prayer partners. You do have cards, I think, to fill out, she was telling me. And if you could get them back to the church by next Sunday, that would be great. Either get up with Jake or Mary Thomas in the office there, and she'll know where they go. Is anything else I'm forgetting? Let's go to the Lord in prayer and be dismissed. Lord, we love you and we thank you for this day. Bless each and every one that's here. Bless the ones that are viewing online. Watch over us through the week and bring us back next week. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.